Welcome to Kevin Deal Photography, where I take you on my journey through photography. On today's episode, we're going to be doing an in-depth review of the Viltrox AF 35mm 1.7 XF. I'm pleased to announce the release of my Capture One and Lightroom presets, Metamorphic Portraits, The Sound of Silver, and Rangefinder. These are all available for purchase at my website. Go to kevindealphotography.com or check out a link in the description below. And now, on to today's episode. Welcome to today's episode. If you're not familiar with Kevin Deal Photography, we do gear reviews, tips, techniques, and tutorials, and sometimes we dive into film. If any of that sounds appealing to you, click the subscribe button below. So if you follow this channel and you are one of the Fuji enthusiasts who are a subscriber, first and foremost, thank you very much. And you will know that I did a review of the Viltrox 56 1.7, and if you didn't, you can check that out in the link in the description below. And in that review, I talked about how that lens for the money was probably the best value portrait lens for the entire Fuji X lineup, especially when it comes to third-party lenses. And so Viltrox approached me once again and said, well, now we have a 35 1.7 in this whole line of 1.7 lenses. Would you like to check it out? And of course I said yes, because who would say no to a free lens? But like all of my reviews, my opinions are going to be my own. It's going to be an independent review, and I have the 35 1.7 right here. Very light. It more or less is a carbon copy of the 56 1.7 in terms of construction, the size of the focus ring, and so on and so forth. It's just a 35 millimeter version of the same lens in terms of looks. And so I already know what to expect there. It's pretty cut and dry. You've got the USB-C port on the bottom and all that. If you're new to the Fuji world and APS-C cameras and all that, and chances are if you're watching this video, you may very well be, because this is an entry priced lens. And so 35 millimeters is what we see with our eyes. So if you look at something and go, I want to take a picture of it and I want it to generally look like what I see as I stand here, 35 millimeter is a great focal length for that. And that makes it a great general walk around lens. So in today's episode, I'm mainly going to shoot general walk around photography. I'm just going to take this lens with me everywhere for a couple weeks, take pictures of what I think is interesting, and I'll throw in a little bit of streets and maybe a little bit of portraiture in there as well, but I'm just mainly going to use it as a general walk around lens. So before we get started on today's episode to test this guy out, let's talk about the specs.
The Viltrox AF 35mm f1.7 XF lens is an autofocus non-image stabilized lens for the Fuji X-mount system. Its focal length of 35mm presents as roughly what you see with your eyes, or in the full frame world, it presents as 53mm. It has an aperture range of f1.7 to f16. Its viewing angle is 45 degrees. It has a minimum focusing distance of 12.96 inches or 33 centimeters. Its magnification is 0.13. Its optical design is 11 elements in 9 groups, and it has 9 rounded aperture blades. Its front filter thread size is 52 millimeters. It has a USB-C port built into the lens for firmware updates. Its dimensions are 2.5 by 2.1 inches or 64 by 54.7 millimeters. Its weight is 5.9 ounces or 170 grams, and it comes in at a street price of $180.
So those are some pretty cool specs, especially considering that price, but none of this matters if the lens can't take great pictures. So let's take our 35 1.7 out into the field right now and see what we can come up with. So I'm here in the streets of downtown Austin, where I'm gonna do a street photography test on this Viltrox 35 1.7. I tend to favor 23 a bit more than 35, truth be told, but a lot of you disagree with me. So
I still use 35. It's probably my second most used focal length of street after 23 and maybe 18 millimeters. And I'm also going to do what I call a continuity of character test. And what I mean by that is they also make a 56 1.7. And so I'm going to take a few shots with both of these lenses because you may be in the market to buy some primes of your own and you're on a strict budget. So you can see how this 35 compares in terms of how the contrast is, how the color reproduction is, etc. And you can see if this 35 pairs well with the 56 in terms of looks to greatly limit the amount of time you spend in post-production, because the files, if they look kind of the same, the only difference is the focal length. That makes it a more consistent shot or a continuity of character. So let's get started. Let's see what kind of shots we can get with this Viltrox AF 35mm 1.7 XF. So I had a lot of fun shooting street photography. This guy was definitely worthy of shooting street. I found that all the images that I shot were nice and sharp and crisp, but I wanted to push the limits a little, so I was going down to do a project on the border of Mexico in the border town of McAllen, where the buildings are very colorful, and I decided I wanted to do some post-editing where I'm pushing the colors pretty hard. I wanted to emulate a little bit of a film look where I'm pushing the oranges a little bit, and I thought I did a fantastic job, as you can see right here. The Viltrox had exceptional image quality, and for the money, I have to say so far, it's a pretty good lens. But no lens is fully tested on this channel until it's tested on portraits. Okay, so I'm sure many of you who are watching this video, while you're happy that you saw me use it for general and street photography, you might actually be considering this for professional use because maybe you can't afford the 35 1.4. It's like, what, $600, $700, something like that. And so I decided to do a portrait shoot with a model I've used before on this channel, actually for another Viltrox review, for the 75 1.2 review. And you can check out a link to that below. But yes, Julia, she's gonna join me for today's session. We're gonna do kind of a cool Jack Bridgeland punk rock kind of look here in this reservoir that has lots of graffiti everywhere. And it'll give me a chance to test out this 35 1.7 for portraiture, which is of course my primary discipline. So let's get started. For both video and stills, this 35 1.7 proved to be a surprise lens in terms of optical quality. And even when I compared it to its 56 1.7 and 75 1.2 Pro brethren, I felt like it held its own and had a pretty good continuity of character. All
I know I started off this episode making it sound like I was just going to use this lens on general walk-around stuff, but the gems tend to find their way onto my professional work, and this 35 1.7 proved to be worthy on my professional work. But how does it do against other lenses in its own class and at its own price point? Let's find out.
So in terms of other lens choices, what is out there? You're probably not considering the 35 1.4 from Fuji, that native lens, because it's 4 times more expensive than this Viltrox. So I'm gonna try to keep it in the third party realm. Yes, there is also a 35 F2, but when I was considering that lens, I actually opted for this Sigma 1.4 because it's a 1.4, a whole stop of light brighter, and I just favored the look a little bit more. So I'm gonna do a comparison between the 35 1.7 from Viltrox, this Sigma 30 1.4, and then this TT Artisan 35 1.8. And you can see my reviews of both of these lenses. I'll leave a link in the description below. I'm gonna do a very non-scientific test. I'm just gonna walk around this park, generally take pictures of the same thing, frame it up. I don't have a tripod, so I'm just gonna frame it the best I can. And we'll go look at the comparisons in post-production in my studio. So let's do a little walk around and let's see what kind of shots we can get with these three lenses and see how this Viltrox 35 1.7 compares to the competition.
All right, I'm gonna do a quick comparison of 3 files taken with each lens, and we'll do a few different scenarios and see which one we like the best from all those shots at that park. So we're gonna start with a sharpness test, a contrast test. We're just gonna zoom in to 100%, let these files render, and now that they have rendered, let's see which one looks the sharpest. I would say that I would give the nod to the two on the left for being sharper than the one on the right. The one on the upper right is the TT Artisan 35 1.8, which is still pretty sharp, but not as good as these other two on the left. When I look at the one in the upper left, I feel like it has a little bit more pop and contrast than the one on the bottom. I think the resolution on the one on the top is a little bit better, and that one is actually the Viltrox 35 1.7. I see pretty decent detail on the bark on all three, but like I said, when I look at the sign, I like the Viltrox a little better than the other two. Now let's try a different example. Let's do another sharpness test, and let me load up all three of these. There's this wilting, dying flower right here, but there's some pretty good detail in the petals. So as I let these load up, I still think all three of them have pretty good detail. Maybe a slight loss of resolution on this one in the upper right, which is once again the TT Artisan. Still not bad. But when I compare these two, I say they're a little bit similar. I would maybe give a nod to the Viltrox, but I really can't say that for sure. They're close enough to where I can't really prefer one over the other. But let's check out the corner sharpness. So as I go to the lower left corner, and keep in mind these are all shot at 4.5, and you can really see the detail in the pebbles on the Viltrox 1.7. They definitely get less detailed on the Sigma 30 1.4, and they're pretty terrible here on the TT Artisan. So 2 out of 2, the Viltrox, in my opinion, is doing as good or better than the twice as expensive Sigma. Let's do a couple more, and let's zoom in on maybe some specular highlights to look at chromatic aberrations. Okay, once again, you can see that this one on the upper right, let me let it load, but I can still tell while it's loading, you can definitely see some purple fringing there on the highlights, that specular highlight. Now let me compare these two. These two are kind of similar, the 30 and the 35, the Sigma and the Viltrox. Let's do one more test. Let's also look for a really crazy specular highlight. And I gotta say that this upper right corner you see right here is not vignetting, it's my car, so don't look at that. But when we're looking at vignetting, let's just look at this left corner. They all kind of look the same. Maybe the TT Artisan has a little bit more vignetting. This is at 1.7, 1.6, and 1.8 respectively, so they're about the same, and this is where you'd typically see vignetting. I don't really think it's too terrible on the Viltrox, but let's do one more quick zoom in on a crazy specular highlight, this pull. Once again, the TT Artisan
Artisan does not hold up to these other two. You can definitely see some purple fringing right there. A little bit of green right there. I would say that maybe you give a slight nod to the Sigma here, but overall, I can't say that the Sigma is better than this Viltrox, and it's twice the price. Sure, it's a sample size of one copy of each lens, so maybe your copies might vary from mine, but overall, I have to say this Viltrox 35 1.7 is pushing the envelope for budget lenses based off of these examples that I shot. So, with this test concluded, let's go back to my studio and let's talk about what I liked and didn't like about the Viltrox 35mm f1.7.
Now that I've had several months to test the Viltrox 35mm f1.7, here's what I think. First off, I want to thank Viltrox for not only providing early access to this lens, but for allowing me to spend several months with it. Too often, manufacturers rush me to do reviews in just a couple of weeks. Viltrox, however, gave me plenty of time to truly evaluate this lens. While I appreciate that Viltrox trusted me with extended access to the lens, I want to say that no product gets a free pass on this channel. So, I'm going to tell you what I like about it, I'm going to tell you what I don't like about it, and Viltrox isn't going to see any of this until right now. So let's dive into the things I didn't like about the lens. One small issue I encountered was with the lens hood. While it's a nice bonus that Viltrox includes one for this sub $200 lens, something that should be standard, and yes, I'm looking at you, Canon, the hood technically does its job, but it's made from very cheap plastic and the design is far from premium. I found it difficult to attach at times. The hood would often twist on but wouldn't lock into place. This was the same issue I had with its brother, the Viltrox 56 f1.7 model, which is essentially the same exact lens, just at 56mm. It's annoying to twist the hood, assuming it's secure, only to have it fall off. In comparison, the TT Artisan 35 f1.8 comes with a more solid metal square lens hood, but this is one of the very few areas where the Viltrox falls short. Another con is the plastic barrel. If you are hoping for the same metal construction found in Fuji's f2 lenses, this may well be a letdown for you. That said, plastic has come a long way, and I find it's not as fragile as some people think. In fact, I've never had a plastic product fail in any of my reviews. Still, holding this lens feels less robust than the 30mm 1.4 from Sigma or the TT Artisan 35 1.8, both of which are made from sturdier materials. Another potential con and concern is the ongoing tariff situation. If the 25% tariff on Chinese goods takes effect, as promised during the US presidential election, the price of this lens could very well rise. Now with the cons out of the way, let's talk about the pros, and there are many of them. Image quality is the highlight of this lens. When I reviewed the 56mm 1.7, I found it close to being as good as the Sigma 56 1.4, which cost twice as much, but the Sigma still had a slight edge. With the Viltrox 35mm 1.7, however, I'd say this lens actually surpasses the more expensive Sigma 30mm f1.4. While the Sigma has a slightly brighter aperture, the Viltrox edges it out in terms of sharpness, contrast, and overall image quality. In terms of continuity of character, I compared the 35mm 1.7 to its 56mm sibling, and I found the files edited very similarly. They look like the same lens at different focal lengths, which is a good thing if you're building a budget kit and you want consistent image quality. Even compared to the Viltrox 75mm f1.2 Pro, this 35mm holds its own, and while the 75mm is sharper, the difference is not significant enough to make the 35mm feel out of place in a professional kit. This lens excels in optical quality, it's sharp in the center with excellent corner sharpness, great color reproduction, and pleasing contrast. The bokeh is smooth, the minimum focusing distance is practical, and flare is well controlled, even when I slapped on the UV Pro MCHT 52mm UV filter. As far as autofocus, the Viltrox is on par with native Fuji lenses. I didn't notice significant autofocus issues, and it performed well in low light and backlit situations. On video, it tracked well, and it didn't struggle in challenging lighting. For a sub-$200 lens, the autofocus performance is impressive. Honestly, if this autofocus were on a $700 native Fuji lens, I'd still be happy with it. One convenient feature of this lens is the built-in USB-C port. While some manufacturers put the USB-C port on the rear lens cap, which means no firmware updates if you lose it, Viltrox has integrated it into the lens. This is the smart move as it allows for firmware updates regardless of whether or not you know the whereabouts of your lens cap. While the plastic barrel is a con for some, I actually prefer the lightweight nature of this lens. It's incredibly portable, which makes it more likely to find a permanent spot in your camera bag. Overall, it performs incredibly well for the price, and it's the best sub-$200 lens I've ever tested. If you're listening, Viltrox, how about adding a 23mm f1.7 or an 18mm f1.7 or perhaps both? That does it for today's episode. If you're interested in the 35mm f1.7 from Viltrox or the Viltrox UV Pro MCHT 52mm UV filter that I used in this episode, I left links in the description below. What do you think? Is this sub-$200 Viltrox lens worth the hype? Let me know in the comments, and if you're a fan of this channel, I humbly ask you to click the subscribe button below, ring that bell, and until next time, I'll talk to you soon. Bye.